In a nutshell, what is Parkinson's disease?
So Parkinson's is a neurodegenerative condition, and really it's based around the depletion of dopaminergic neurons in an area of the brain called the substantia nigra. And dopamine is, I guess, the main character in the story of Parkinson's. And dopamine is a neurotransmitter that's responsible for being able to move well, so moving fluidly, but also sort of thinking well and emotional resilience as well.
So what are some of the early symptoms of Parkinson's?
When we think about Parkinson's disease, we think about the motor symptoms and the non-motor symptoms. So I think the motor symptoms are slowness of movement, sometimes called bradykinesia, rigidity or stiffness, tremor, and also balance not being quite right or postural instability. But the thing about Parkinson's disease is it's not just about those movement symptoms. There's a whole panoply of other symptoms called the non-motor symptoms, which often can be more trouble to patients than the movement ones. And those non-motor symptoms are wide-reaching and include problems with blood pressure control, things like depression, anxiety, apathy, and a whole host of other things, including bowel and urinary function and that kind of thing.
So one of the first things I noticed was the what you call fine motor control. I had trouble with handwriting, and I had the stiffness that you mentioned. But it took me a couple of years to get diagnosed. Is that a common problem?
Yes, it is. Sometimes people present often to other specialists, like orthopaedic surgeons, for example, with frozen shoulders or difficulties with their fine motor control, which they think might be due to sort of neck problems or those kinds of things. And sometimes people just attribute it, for older people, just to aging. But often I think that when we notice a pattern of symptoms arising, then it lends itself more to the diagnosis. But you're right when you say that often people, there's a delay to the diagnosis.
So if I have a few of the symptoms you just mentioned, and I suspect I have Parkinson's, but I'm not sure, what route should I take?
Well, I think the first thing to do would be to speak to a general practitioner, a primary care, so your family doctor. They may then refer you to a specialist, either a neurologist or a Parkinson's specialist, to evaluate things further.
What sort of people does Parkinson's affect? Does it affect men more than women, for example?
Really tricky question. So yes, I think there is a slight sex imbalance. I think men are slightly affected more than women. As to what kind of people, it's a wide variety of people. What people often think about Parkinson's is it's a disease of an older person, but actually 10% of people are diagnosed under the age of 50 and 5% are diagnosed under the age of 40. So it is quite a wide-ranging condition.
Can you inherit Parkinson's?
Yes, you can. The majority of Parkinson's disease is what we call idiopathic, which means we don't know why it's arisen, because it's not genetically inherited from one's parents. But there are some genetic forms of Parkinson's disease, and there are various genes which have been identified. The Parkin gene and the LARC2 gene are examples of those, which do lead to familial types of Parkinson's disease. But these tend to be diagnosed younger, under the age of 40, typically, although there are forms which can be diagnosed a little bit later.
So what you're saying is if you have Parkinson's at a younger age, you're more likely to have a genetic factor. If you have Parkinson's when you're older, it's more likely to be what you call idiopathic.
Largely, I think the inherited Parkinson's diseases are more likely to be diagnosed when you're younger. But idiopathic Parkinson's disease can affect younger people too.
So what causes Parkinson's?
Now that is a really challenging question to answer. So there are many hypotheses about what causes Parkinson's, but I think the best assessment is looking at the gut, the so-called gut hypothesis, starting with what's called the microbiome. Trillions of viruses and bacteria that live in your gut weigh about 2 kilograms, and these are all in a very healthy balance. But we think that what happens in Parkinson's disease is that balance becomes unsettled. And then what happens is that the gut becomes slightly leaky, and that means that certain bacteria can go across the intestinal lining, and then that leads to the deposition of something called alpha-synuclein, which is the main thing which starts the neurodegenerative process, and that sort of travels up towards the brain, and that begins the process of neurodegeneration.
Is it possible to get Parkinson's through contact sports, through head injuries, for example?
Again, that's quite a difficult question to answer. But I would say that what I wouldn't want ever for people to think is that by playing contact sports, they're going to run an increased risk of developing Parkinson's disease, because exercise is really a useful tool in managing Parkinson's and even perhaps reducing the one's risk of developing it. However, there is some data about people, and you'll be aware, I think, of footballers that have headed heavy balls in the past or that kind of thing, or boxers, for example, look at Muhammad Ali, who have received multiple blows to the head and then go on to develop some neurodegenerative illnesses. So there may well be, but I think the evidence isn't strong enough to make a causal link, but perhaps a contributory one.
Are there any environmental factors, any toxins, for example, that could contribute to Parkinson's?
Yes, so the toxins that are related with Parkinson's disease include things like organophosphates in pesticides. And so there is a little bit of data. People living in rural communities can be slightly more likely to develop Parkinson's disease. There's also links to things like manganese and aluminium, but these are slightly tenuous. But I think, you know, those kinds of toxins are more likely to lead to Parkinson's disease or contribute to people developing it.
Is there anything I can do to lower my risk of getting Parkinson's later in life, particularly if I have a relative that has Parkinson's and I'm at risk of a genetic factor?
So I've mentioned exercise. Exercise is really good. And the evidence really is for high intensity exercise, one where you get your heart rate up for short periods of time. Any exercise is better than none. Also, Mediterranean diet is supposed to be also very good, rich in antioxidants and low in sort of saturated fat and that kind of thing. That's also very, very good. And obviously trying to remove things like excessive alcohol consumption and those kinds of things.
And obviously that's good general healthy living regardless of the risk of Parkinson's. So how many people have Parkinson's disease?
I think in the United Kingdom, for example, there's about 150 to 170,000 people with Parkinson's disease. It's the second most common neurodegenerative condition after Alzheimer's disease.
And given that we have an ageing population globally, can we expect more Parkinson's going forward?
Yes, I think so. I think as people live longer, their likelihood of having dopamine depletion goes up. And as we get better at diagnosing and as people age, then I think the diagnosis rate will go up.
And how does Parkinson's progress after the first few years?
Everybody is very individual with their Parkinson's journey. Generally, we describe a diagnosis phase, which is where we're sort of honing the diagnosis. We're making sure that we're correct with the diagnosis. And that can last a little amount, sort of a few months. And then typically getting the medication right and entering what's called a maintenance phase, which could last for some time. What did you notice in your Parkinson's journey? What happened to you in the sort of diagnosis and maintenance phase?
Well, it's interesting you talk about the non-motor, because I think it started off very much with the motor symptoms. That's what I noticed first. But all the non-motor stuff started to creep in over the last sort of 5 or 6 years. So sleep problems, particularly at the start, which have actually got slightly better, interestingly. That's the one thing that's slightly improved since the early days. I think what I notice amongst colleagues who have Parkinson's is it is highly variable. So there's some people that have, unfortunately, dementia, cognitive decline, whereas other people have no mental problems at all. So it does vary a lot from what I've seen.
Exactly that. And I think that one, therefore, can't compare oneself to anybody else that you might know with Parkinson's disease and look to see what their journey has been, because yours is likely to be very, very different.
Yeah, I think that's an important message for people listening, which is there's all these things you can read about, all these quite scary things you could potentially get. But of course, that doesn't necessarily mean you're going to get them. They're just possible outcomes. Parkinson's is a progressive neurodegenerative condition that affects an estimated 10 million people globally. It initially presents most commonly as a movement disorder, with symptoms including stiffness, slowness of movement, and tremor. It also has a wide range of non-motor symptoms, including sleep problems, constipation, and depression.